See the little Wi-Fi like thing lights up.
Got it.
Now we are on Facebook Live.
Well, good morning, Facebook Live.
Hello, Facebook Live. It's a rare morning show.
It is a rare morning show.
Although especially on the West Coast.
Yeah, and 7 o'clock for me seems like the middle of the day because I'm, you know, usually up for 2 hours by now, which is sad, but it's me.
Actually, that's probably good.
Yeah. What I think it is it's old age. Catching up.
So the reason we are here is, in addition to me checking to see if we're live, and we appear to be, and adding a member to the group, this would be Scott Phillips.
Welcome, Scott. How many we're up to?
2,474 members. Ooh. Yay. We got to do some more on that thing that you pulled out on Parity Act. Some interesting comments here, but that's not why we're here right now. This is why we're here. Major friend of the show. In contention for number one fan, Mark Cartwright, who caused me to upgrade my on the road audio capabilities with a headset that he funded fully eventually. Pointed us
on the road for the next on the road show that you're not going to do.
I'll probably do one on the way to St. Louis. Or on the way back.
Got it.
He pointed us to this little news story from an Idaho TV station that okay, so now we're not seeing the news story anymore.
Oh, in their feed. It's probably down below their feed.
Well, yeah, that's
the weird because that took you to the Facebook page. When I got the link, it took me to the article itself.
Maybe I pushed the wrong button. There we go. So, Payette County. Why does that sound like a vague drug reference? Oh, that would be Peyote County.
Yeah, there you
go. Probably isn't one of those. Payette County declares local disaster ahead of upcoming eclipse. Boise, Idaho. K-Boy. Hey, Gary Pierce here, coming to you from KBOI. Good morning, everybody. It's K-Boy. I'm the K-Boy. That may be why my radio career never really took off. The Payette County commissioners have declared a local disaster emergency in anticipation of the total eclipse on Monday, October 21st. The county says the declaration has been issued due to the risk of public safety, financial damage, labor costs, cleanup, property damage are possible during the event.
It makes sense. That all totally makes sense. Public safety covers all this stuff that I'm worried about.
I'm having trouble controlling.
Yeah. 10,000 and 100,000 to travel to Payette County. I wonder how many people are in Payette County.
Probably, you know, a couple thousand.
Yeah.
And if that's the county that's got Boise in it, it's going to be a little bigger.
Yeah.
They're already preparing for congested traffic crashes, medical calls, and fires. Okay, so they've already been thinking about that. So what we were wondering is ARES, is there a ham radio mission here? And is anyone gearing up for that? Because if you're not planning on going to the eclipse and you're not already in a 100-mile or so zone from where the path of totality is, you're not thinking about it very much. But for the folks that are within 100 or so miles, the folks that are within a relatively easy drive of the path of totality, your media has been telling you for weeks now to prepare for gridlock. There are events everywhere from planetariums and museums, and they've been sold out for months.
Yeah, all the parks, hotels probably are.
Yeah, hotels, parks. But folks that live within an hour or 3's drive don't need a hotel. You drive in, you watch the eclipse, you drive home. The totality lasts for under 3 minutes. The exciting part lasts for a couple of hours. And so you just drive over there and you watch and you drive back, except you're not going to be able to drive there unless you leave way, way early, because it's everyone is expecting gridlock. So now we are going to have, in any given area, and especially the rural areas, because some people will realize that the cities are going to, the few cities that it covers, the rural areas are going to be particularly popular with, mm-hmm. you know, thousands to tens of thousands of people in counties that normally don't have very many. Some of the counties have interstates going through them. A lot don't. So their communications infrastructure is going to be overloaded. You know, not very many cell sites out there.
Mm-hmm. Well, and even like all the emergency services, you know, are sized. So I looked up Payette County's 22,000 people. So, you know, emergency services in that county is scaled for 22,000 people. And so what happens if 100,000 people show up in the county? And, you know, I would wonder, I guess, if I was going to go, thinking about my recent trip to New Mexico, am I going to go to a city, or am I going to just find a place, a wide spot in the road where I can pull over, or a rest stop, or, you know, just a rural spot? And then what happens if something happens when I'm there? Can I make a cell phone call? Probably not. And even if I'm in if I'm in the range of a cell site, again, if the influx of people are, you know, times five, is it going to be able to scale and capable of handling that? That's a good map shot.
Yeah. And,
you know, Nebraska, look at Nebraska there, right? I mean, if you just think about, there's the interstate that it goes across, and
briefly,
not a lot of city. Yeah, briefly. But, well, that's actually a pretty good swath if you look at the way it curves. And in between, scroll up just a teeny bit. So whatever those cities' names are,
Grand Island.
Yeah, like between Lexington and Kearney, right? Is you're in the totality. There's probably not a lot in between the two. Oh, you went the wrong way. But I could stop on the side of the 80, you know, I-80 there, and watch it without, you know, I guess if the highway's moving.
Yeah, so nobody knows if all of Interstate 80 across Nebraska here is going to be a gridlock or not.
Right, exactly.
But there's probably places that, and because this is so rural, well, you know, Denver's not very far away, and they're talking about this territory from Casper, Wyoming, down to Lincoln, Nebraska, as being the prime potential for clear weather. And, of course, an overcast sky is just, you know, going to
be a fail.
Well, as my wife says, because she's planning on going down to Columbia, I'm going out to Wyoming. She's planning on going down to Columbia. And the reason we're splitting up is she wants to take her dad, and her dad is late 80s, so he's too old to make the airplane trip. But from Charlotte to Columbia is that hour drive.
Hopefully.
Under normal circumstances.
So right.
Not going to be on that Monday. So that territory is going to get gridlocked no matter what. Mm-hmm. You know, go take a look at that, and you'll see that it is.
Yeah, that's a populated area.
Yeah. I mean, there's plenty of rural territory out here, and it's, you know, just down from Charlotte.
Zoom in a little bit more. So, because then you can see all the cities. So there's all those cities in there, and all the interstates. So what Cindy's plan is, she trying to get into Columbia, or if it's okay if she just makes it to Lexington, or, you know, between like, you know, Aiken and Lexington, you know, as long as you're in the totality, you're in the totality.
Yeah. So her plan would probably be to get in somewhere along here where it's relatively rural. She may stay north of I-26, you know, take these back roads. But, you know, that's her plan, but that's everybody's plan.
Right. Yeah, see, I haven't thought about this at all because I just know at some point during the day, I'm going to go outside at my work and I'm not going to get the sunglasses, but I'm going to, you know, have a piece of stock paper with a hole in it, and I'm going to project it on the, you know, on the ground and look at it that way. because I'm hours and hours. I mean, even by air travel, I think I'm a 2-hour flight or a 3-hour flight away from any of it. But I'll see a quarter or a little bit more where we are in Los Angeles. But I haven't thought about the what are the logistics to get to where this would all be. But if you look there, like, you know, look, the city of Eugene is probably the biggest one below, and above is Portland. Are all those people going to be streaming up and down to get towards, you know, Salem or the roads in between? And I guess I could imagine that would be, you know, the five's going to be gridlock.
Yeah, five will be gridlock for sure. We'll be going out of Denver.
So you guys will be in Denver.
Yeah, we're going to stay near Denver, and there.
And so the question is, yeah, do you go up the 25 or the 76, or do you take back roads?
Yeah, well, we're going to plan back roads, and you know, leave at O'Dark 30, O too early. Uh-huh, and you know, our goal is to be someplace up here in eastern Wyoming.
Yeah, we call that stupid o'clock.
Yeah, Katie, if you're watching, Katie, if you're watching, come down and see us.
Yeah. And so I wonder, will Waze be your friend? Everybody will get on the social media navigation software so that everybody can see where they're going, and hopefully it will help.
Yeah,
everyone.
Well, at least Google Maps will be my friend, because it'll show traffic. Yeah. It'll show where the gridlock is. So, you know, there's a surprising number of people that I have traveled with. Well, there aren't that many people that I've traveled with. But of the people that I have traveled with, a surprising number of them had no experience with Google Maps, either for traffic or routing or, you know, for anything, other than maybe they looked at it once in a while. I live in Google Maps when I'm in the car.
Yeah, I switch between the Google Maps and Waze, even though, you know, Google owns them now.
Yeah.
But I think
Waze had always bogged down whatever device I was trying to run it on. Maybe I've got a Nexus 6P phone now. Probably would work okay there. So it also it looked a little too clunky to use while you were driving, which is it's what it's designed to be. It seemed to me like a distraction generator. Ooh, look, there's an accident ahead. Let me see what the accident's all about. Oh, look, there's an accident right around me now.
Right. And they want you to vote whether there's a police car up ahead or whatever. So, you know, this is turning into be a really good Facebook. There was 7 people in the room, lots of people asking questions.
Oh, guess we should look.
So Emil Toller wanted to know what was the forecast of people movement based on previous events. Has there been a previous event like this? I don't think.
No.
I don't think there, you know, I mean, in recent history of this magnitude, I can't think of anything. You know, this big across, you know, the biggest thing about this is for the event, even though it's spread out over a number of hours, it will cover the whole country, you know, in some way, shape or form. And there is this big path, like 30 miles of a big path where it's going to get dark and people want to see that for whatever reason.
Yeah. There hasn't been anything like this. And again, here in Raleigh, we are a reasonable drive away from Totality in South Carolina, but 44% chance of a clear day. So it takes your chances. As Cindy says, I think I was getting up to what Cindy was going to say, but never quite got there. It's still going to get dark. It may be cloudy, but it's still going to become nighttime for a couple of minutes in the middle of the day, and it's still going to be weird. So it's going to be worth being there, whether it's a nice, clear, sunny day or not. And of course, you know, what I'm thinking is going to happen is that I've taken the trouble to go all the way out to Wyoming, and I'm going to get socked in, and she is going to have a bright, clear, sunny day.
Yeah.
And that's going to happen.
It's possible.
Yeah. So our mission here, our question is, what can ham radio reasonably do about the role that we can take in providing communications? Mm-hmm. We can be, if we do it, we can be a thin presence across the rural areas. Mm-hmm. But we will have the ability either through, because our VHF and UHF repeaters tend to cover literally everywhere, to at least mobiles, not handy talkies, but at least mobiles. I've rarely encountered rural territory that is out of range of any repeater. There's nobody on them.
Right.
Can't find anybody to talk to, but they're there. You can kerchunk them.
Yeah, I drove all across New Mexico on 14652 calling every, you know, I called at least every 15 minutes or so, and I didn't get one signal, single response.
Yeah. Somebody mentioned some time ago, I think it was, would be a great idea, an auto announce generator for folks traveling down the road.
Yeah.
And every 15 minutes, somebody that's going your direction, you're going to catch them, but somebody going the opposite direction, you've got a window of simplex of about 5 minutes.
Yeah, I guess it depends on where you are.
Yeah.
You know, across the flat parts of the plains, you
right.
probably have a little bit more.
Yeah. Well, you've got a typical 50-watt mobile in flat territory at 15 miles, you have gotten so noisy it's not really worth talking.
Yeah, that's probably true.
So 10 miles is pretty good.
So about 10 minutes of driving opposite directions at 50 miles an hour.
I can't do the math in my head. In 10 minutes, you've gone 10 miles. But the other guy going the opposite direction has also gone 10 miles. So you've got about 5 minutes of communications time. So if you're beaconing every couple of minutes, then you might catch somebody.
Yeah.
I've only caught people going my direction. And most of that has happened because one of us saw the other's car and license plate.
Right. You saw either the antenna sticking out of the top or the hand plate, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, just gave it a shot on 5.2. And that's about a 10% success rate.
Yeah.
Maybe 10% is high. I've also got APRS going in the car and a voice alert, something called voice alert, APRS voice alert. Mm-hmm. What that does is you add 100 hertz tone to your APRS beacon. And you keep a receiver going on the APRS frequency, 144.39. And anybody else who's doing what Bob Berninga determined to be voice alert, their beacon will come out, you know, peck it brap, you know, brap. But you'll hear that. Yeah, you'll hear that. And because you heard it, you know they were sending 100 hertz tone. And because they sent 100 hertz tone, you know that 15 years ago when they set it up, they intended to be able to talk to you on simplex. Of course, they forgot that they were doing that, and they're not really equipped to talk to you on simplex, although I still am. I've got a whole radio dedicated to one side is APRS, the other side is 5.2 simplex.
Right.
And once in a while, because I'm crazy. You've seen my car.
Yeah, I've seen it. Every once in a while, somebody gets in my car, and they're like, really, two radios? And I'm like, no, it's actually three.
Are you counting the broadcast or a handy talkie?
Oh no! There's two mobiles mounted, but you know one of them's a 8900. So you know there's kind of like three radios in there.
Okay.
And one, you know, one's APRS and one's 5.2 and one's one of the repeaters. So I'm looking back.
Okay, so you got APRS going in your car. Do you do the voice alert? Did you know about that?
It will tell me. Yeah, I've got it set up.
But okay.
You very rarely hear anybody do anything with it.
Yeah.
So looking back through the Facebook group. Sorry, I got us down the rabbit hole here. Robert Lang says in Nashville, all kinds of parties, music shows, special events, expecting a flood of tourists. Some say 100,000 mark, and he's going to be working his butt off. Not sure what he does, but you know, so that's in Nashville. But what about, you know, the surrounding areas? You know, I think I'd be just happy enough to not go in the cities and stop at the side of the road, whether it's a rest stop or, you know, a turnoff where, you know, the trucks stop and park at night. So that they can get some shut eye, to just be in the path, maybe more quiet and peaceful. And, you know, if you're in the totality, you're in the totality. And then what happens if I, you know, have a heart attack or, you know, twist my ankle or, you know, who knows what happens.
Yeah. And Robert Long is ARES planning on doing anything, you know, going back to the ham radio thing that we were talking about and can't seem to stick to. So we can provide a relatively thin overlay of communications across this territory, and the more rural, probably the more useful. Mm-hmm. Being there and talking to ourselves would be interesting to us, but not useful to the public other than, we could get a message through. Being there in cooperation with the agencies that we serve, emergency management and you know, through them, state police, local authorities, even Red Cross, would seem to be more useful. I've initiated a request for an interview with ARL headquarters. I won't say I was rebuffed. I will say that because I redirected. I sent it to Mike Corey, and he said, you got to ask the PR guy, which has never happened before, but that's what happened today.
I'll keep my fingers crossed that that's a positive.
Yeah. So I did that. I sent the note to Sean and said, here's, you know, is anything coming through ARL? Is there any chatter? Now, David, you were talking to me before we went on Facebook Live that you have some emergency management contacts, not just local, but, you know, magazines and websites and stuff, I guess.
Yep.
You know, I suppose I could do a Google search. Let's type in.
So you're searching. So, Jim, Aspinwall, who was one of our guests earlier on, made a comment asking about, you know, are we talking about hams talking to hams, or, you know, doing what we can do to help. And I think, you know, my goal would be to do what we could do to help. You know, one of the things I thought about when we started the conversation over email, Gary, was a great kind of example of this in a localized area was the Women's March after the election in Washington, D.C., right, where they had hundreds of thousands of people show up in a small area and overwhelmed all of the cell sites and communications. And, you know, a bunch of volunteers stepped up and were able to provide, you know, relays for people that had strokes or heart attacks or other things in that localized area. Now, so this takes this from the District of Columbia to the entire country, if the turnout is the turnout that we think it might be, right? And so how do you take that where we had an ARES activation, or even not an official activation, you just had hams step up to say, hey, you're going to need help and we're going to provide it, in that small, you know, 5 square mile area, to a path across the country that literally will cover, you know, the country, you know, 30 miles wide from, you know, from Oregon to the, you know, the coast of South Carolina or North Carolina, wherever it goes across. How do we prepare to provide the support where there's an influx of people that may need help?
So I was looking at, I did a search for emergency management response to Eclipse and pulled out the first couple. And as you might imagine, emergency management across the country has been thinking about this for a while.
Yeah.
So in Oregon, you know, they're got suggestions for residents and visitors, and, you know, nobody's mentioning ham radio, as you might expect. Kentucky is pretty much the same thing. They begin by explaining what a solar eclipse is.
Right. Massive influx of visitors.
Yeah. When they say things like the longest duration of the eclipse extends from Carbondale to Hopkinsville, Kentucky, it's going to be about 12 seconds longer than what we'll see in Wyoming. So...
But they get it there in that swath.
Yeah, I've got a thing about headlines, and headline bites. That wasn't the headline, but it's a headline bite, where you say something, and it has a certain impact, and then you look at the real numbers, and the impact is much, much less. Yeah. You know, a lot of advertising, you'll see the fastest growing, blah, blah, blah. Well, that means that they're 1% faster than someone else, and it's still not that big a deal. But the fastest growing sounds really big. So anyway, they'll have the longest duration. But anyway, you know, they have been planning. So they don't mention amateur radio. So I guess, our question is, we haven't heard anything in the ham radio circuits about it. And it seems to me that because so much of this is going to be rural, and it's going to be apparently huge, and stress resources, and particularly communications. Not necessarily communications for the agencies, but communications for the public. Maybe for the agencies.
Well, it kind of goes hand in hand, right?
Yeah, and we're not expecting any natural disasters. There'll be some, but no, not expecting much. I don't have a good enough handle on the agency's communications capabilities. If the fan really gets flooded with crap, yeah, they could discover that things are stretched pretty thin there too. But for hams, you know, going back to the question, what could we do other than be there? And maybe being there is important enough.
Right.
You know, maybe they've got enough highway patrol and county sheriffs to report in and say, and tell emergency management and state officials what the real situation is just about every place. You know, maybe there really isn't a place.
Yeah.
But we don't prepare for maybe there isn't. We prepare for maybe there is.
Right.
I think.
And it's a hard question. And again, because it's such a, you know, my big thing is it's such a long, it's such a big path that, you know, 30 miles wide across the whole country. I don't know if anybody's done the calculations if you know how many square miles it covers, you know, over that period of time. Like, if you were to mobilize, if you needed to be mobilized, how do you do it? And there isn't, I mean, other than a group like ARES or RACES or MARS from, you know, an amateur radio perspective, there isn't a group. It's, you know, a bunch of groups that would, you know, need to step up. And again, like you said, for a small period of time, but what do you do with all the people that, you know, like you're going to get up at 3 or 4 in the morning and start driving north, right? And there's probably a whole bunch of people that are going to get up at 3 or 4 in the morning and start driving south. And, you know, what happens to the roads and the this and the that? And there will be accidents because accidents happen. And so how do you get the first responders to those locations, or how do they even know in the rural areas that those things happened? And yeah. That's I guess where amateur radio could play a role, maybe not.
Well, yeah, I guess no matter how dense the official coverage is, there's places that where when something happens bad, it won't get attention, and we won't be able to cover all those places either. But if we fill in another 10% of them, that's better than not.
Yeah,
but I don't think it can happen ad hoc. It maybe sort of it could, and, you know, we could have on repeaters that cover the totality zone. We could, you know, somebody, an ARES group sort of step up and say, all right, you know, we'll run a sort of an informal net.
Yeah.
And if you're, you know, out there and you see something, well, here's your ability to get a message through, assuming that when you pick up your phone, you got no bars or it goes, try your call again later. All circuits are busy.
And that's the part I think that's going to be the issue, is all the circuits are going to be overwhelmed and busy. And you know, I guess if you did have somebody running a net and somebody in the EOC and you can get that message to say, you know, here's a problem. And then I wonder, like, can you really even get people to respond to that if there is the gridlock that some of the places are talking about?
Well, that's their problem.
Yeah.
I mean, our job would be to let them know. I mean, it would be nice. If we're doing CERT or something where we've had some primary first response medical training and the minimal tools that you have for doing something like that. So, that's it. The other side of that coin, the one that I've always been more involved with than the actual emergency side, is the publicity. Seems to me to be a golden opportunity to say, look at all this activity going on in rural areas with minimal communications, and ham radio is stepping up, and we will be there across the country with our communications capabilities, our never fail, and adding to the safety net that the rest of emergency management is planning to provide. Because we've got something nobody else has.
Mm-hmm. That's the job.
If we're not doing that, we're probably missing a bet.
And I wonder if there's going to be people that would say, well, that's great, but I want to watch the eclipse.
I think you can do both.
Yeah, I would think you could do both.
You know, I changed my plans when I was realizing this from ham radio is not going to be a major part of it to I'm going to at least have, I don't know if I'll bring a mobile radio out because we're flying and, you know, trying to stay very light.
Yeah.
But I'll have a couple of handhelds and power, extra batteries and car power and an antenna to stick on the car. And a plan for frequencies. You know, that's the plan for frequencies and programming the radios, especially if I do my current hotness DMR. It's going to take all day one day. Don't know where I'm going to get that day. But an idea what, you know, what I can hit out there in rural Wyoming. And, you know, there we run into another issue, and that is our ability to learn what is really on the air and how it covers and what activity there is pathetic compared to what it could be.
Yeah.
But that's a story for another show.
That will be.
Yeah. I don't know. Do you got anything else to
add? No, I think that covers it. We actually had a pretty good show. We had like 9 people at one point. We're at 7 right now. Some good questions in the Facebook room. Some interesting perspective on what we're doing or not doing or how it goes.
I don't know if I see live updates to this. I don't know whether the new stuff is at the top or at the bottom.
It's usually the new stuff's at the top, and I've been finding that I have to refresh and go back to it again to get the feed to come through. Well, here we go. Robert Long said he'll be at the Grand Ole Opry, so he'll be busy, but probably not on the radio.
Yeah, so Jim Aspinwall is wondering how many states and counties have preemptively declared states of emergencies like the Idaho county did. Emil says use the media to promote the ham radio part.
Yep. And that's what I would hope to. I'll definitely going to bring it up. I've got an ARES meeting Saturday morning, you know, our monthly meeting, and I'll definitely bring it up just to ask the question, like, what do people think? And I know we're so far out of the path of this all that it won't be an event here. You know, it'll be everybody's going to probably like get up from their office chairs. I don't even know exactly what the time is, but I know it's in the morning here. We're going to all get up from our desks at work, and we're probably all going to go outside all across, you know, parts of California and, you know, look up with the glasses or down with the cards and whatever to see what we could see or not see. It won't be the kind of event. There won't be throngs of people coming here because it's not going to be, that kind of event here. But, you know, where you're looking at right now in, you know, between, what do we say, between Eugene and Portland, which is rural. I've driven that road a number of times. It's going to be probably gridlock. You know, if I was in Eugene or if I was in Portland and I knew I could drive, you know, an hour north or an hour south to get in the middle of it, I'd go and try.
So it says straight north of you is going to be the maximum will be at UTC 17:19. Can you convert that to local time?
No, I can never do that. It's like, so that's like 11 in the morning.
Well,
right?
5:20, 5:20 UTC. So 1:20 here in North Carolina. 10:20.
So like 10:20.
Yeah, it's gonna be 11:20 in Wyoming, which is mountain time. So 10:20, where you guys are.
Yeah. So like 10 in the morning, people are gonna get up from their desks and they're gonna go outside. And you know, the problem we're gonna have at my office is it's gonna be gridlock in the stairwells. You know, and I'll probably go out a little earlier and I'll have the lawn chair in my car and, you know, whatever. And we'll just go sit and see what it looks like. But we're only going to get, you know, 25% or something like that.
And you wouldn't know if it were gridlock. You wouldn't know if it was gridlock because of the eclipse, because your traffic is constant gridlock no matter what.
Yeah, that's a rumor, but mostly. There are hours. That is actually outside. that's outside. So the max, 1021, I pulled it up here. 1021 will be the maximum of the eclipse. And that's outside of, kind of outside of our general gridlock hours. But, you know, it's going to be like a quarter sun or less than a quarter sun. So it'll get dark-ish here for that period of time. And
obscuration. So let me get zoomed in to really get it, your area, although it won't change much.
Yeah, it won't change a lot.
Yeah, 61% obscured. So more than half.
Yeah, more than half. Yeah, it's just it's going to be a sliver. So it'll get dark, and I think that's what people will want to see. But, you know, I don't know what else you do with that. And I'm definitely not. It looks like 2 hours from the start to the end. I'm not going to go for the 2 hours. I'll go at, you know, 10:10. I'll go outside for a little bit, and we'll see what it looks like. And I guess my assumption will be that lots of other people will be doing that. And yeah, I'll have an HD with me just in case.
Yep. And if anybody's wondering where I'm looking at this pretty wonderful map, it's eclipse2017.org. Eclipse2017.org. And then I clicked on this thing here in the middle. And that's the map. And he takes money if you want to send him some money for doing the work to build this map. Yeah, all right, so cool. We'll see if we get a response from headquarters. If we don't, you're going to make some contacts with.
Yeah, I've got the map, the path of the map, and I'm going to see what I can find in the bigger cities for ARES groups or races, and see if anybody has any plans or want to talk, and we could do a quote unquote real show.
Yeah,
if we can make it work, we've got 18 days. But how long until you go?
Well, I'll be leaving like Friday.
Friday. Okay. So we'll see if we get one in between now and then. And if not, I'm still working on getting me set up. So I'll do the best that I can and maybe put a show up anyways.
Yeah. This is exciting. David can possibly do solo shows.
I'm going to try.
The West Coast Bureau is gearing up.
Woo!
Well, because I'm going to be gone for starting with the eclipse and then most of the rest of September.
Yeah.
Between vacation, a bike tour event, and the Tapper conference. So it's gonna rest on David's shoulders.
Yep. I'm gonna do my best. I'm gonna get at least a show or two out during the period of time. I just gotta find some folks to talk to. If not, I'm just gonna sit here in the studio and talk to everybody out there on my own.
Marty and Sam will fill in for you.
There you go. We could maybe resurrect Sterling. And I sent you that article that
I was going to say something nasty about Sterling, but I changed my mind and decided not to, because we could. He's not hopeless yet.
He's starting his new life. He's got to have some space for that. I totally get it.
There's burnout. There's definitely burnout when you start doing something like this. People tell me the number of the average podcast gets to before they give up is 7 to 10.
All right. Well, I think I've made it past that point. I know you've made it.
Well, you haven't done it in the solo mode. So
that's true.
But I mean, just being able to show up here, because you have done great in. I tell you, here's something that's coming up. Can you make it? And you scramble.
Yeah.
You got a real job, and sometimes that gets in the way, or a Boy Scout event or something. But most of the time, you've managed to get there.
Most of the time.
That is dedication. That was the dedication I was looking for in a co-host.
There you go. I got to wonder what's wrong with me. Well, actually, you know, it's mostly the daytime shows have been, you know, lunch hour, and you know, my employer, I get my stuff done, that they don't watch over me like a hawk. So I get a conference room. I go in the conference room. What I got to do is I got to probably buy one more camera. So although you said the camera, the recording was pretty good from the last show we did. That was just for my MacBook.
It looked fine. Yeah. Okay. It was a little washed out, but it wasn't bad.
Yeah. But, and that might be that conference room.
So you need to have your work mic.
Yeah. Although that I had like, that's my office headset is a Microsoft like Life Chat. That didn't sound so good.
It was okay. It wasn't. It was guest quality.
Oh, okay.
Not host quality.
All right. So before I get another camera, I'll get another microphone.
I would. Yeah. I would.
And they had this. They had this really cool. So I actually, we have an internal website, and we do a kind of a. It's called Take Five. It's like a little 5-minute company's update. And I was a guest spot this week, and they had an XLR recording plugin that they put on the bottom of a mic. And I might invest in one of those too, because I'm hoping to do some more remote shots. But what I figured out was my Canon digital SLR will do high def video, but the recording is only through the crappy microphone that's built into the camera itself. It doesn't have any port out. But if I can plug that little recorder in the bottom of like this microphone. And record it, then I can pull it together in Premiere and make that work. In fact, I'm gonna try to roll a part of a show. We're gonna do Angel's Crest 100 this weekend, so I'm gonna try to get a little bit of a show together. And I don't know if you're gonna try to do anything on the bike race. So maybe after you get back, we'll cut together another show about more public service stuff.
Yeah, I did one last year. And things don't change that fast, so
yeah,
I probably won't. This is what the pictures look like from that show when you're at the office. Well, it's not bad. I don't think it was widescreen. I think it was 3x4.
Yeah, I think it's 3x4 in that one.
The one thing that I would suggest is get a stack of books. Put them underneath the laptop.
Yep.
Bring it up to eye level.
I'm gonna bring an empty box next time.
Yeah. Although that background's not bad.
Okay.
Most people who are doing something like that, their background is the ceiling, lights from the ceiling and stuff. So at least we were looking at some nice art. But yes. It's what I refer to as the up your nose shot.
Right.
And
okay, that's good. Pretty easy. I can definitely do. I could definitely do a empty cardboard box to bring it up. Somewhere I have a fold-up stand that'll tilt the laptop up so it's like a regular monitor, and that might help as well.
I totally forgot that I can do titles.
This video looks awesome.
Yeah, your studio quality here.
Yeah, except the door's open. I guess I was moving stuff around. I guess I turned it so it's not just looking at that.
That's okay.
And there's Arvin. Wait, Arvin next to my truck.
Haven't even done a... And haven't even done a pitch. So, yeah. Even the Facebook Live is brought to you by you. And there we go. HamRadioNow.tv. I am going broke. The Ham Radio Now bank account is dwindling because it was also my freelance bank account, and I'm not doing freelance anymore. So it's the money that comes in from Ham Radio Now. I'm going to have to move a couple of recurring expenses out of that account. Otherwise, it's going to go to zero.
Uh-oh.
And I'm thinking for the Tapper conference, I probably ought to run a quick Kickstarter, $2,000 or $3,000, just to cover the out-of-pocket expenses that are otherwise going to be hard to fund, because that will zero out the bank account fast.
The driving and the hotel and meals and whatever.
That is it. Mileage. Hotels, a little bit of food. So
yeah, I was hoping they were going to take it to Seattle. I know that last year they were talking about doing that, and I think I could have worked out a couple of no cost airline tickets from Miles. And I have friends up there I could probably bunk with, but that didn't work out. Maybe next time.
Yeah, I didn't get the bottom line on what happened there, but it was basically couldn't. The facility that they used last time they were there got too expensive.
Yeah.
I think they worked a pretty good deal the first time, and they couldn't work that deal again. And they couldn't find another venue that was affordable. So they were able to do that in St. Louis. It's they don't make money off of it. It is... pretty much break even for Tapper. Mm-hmm. This is the digital communications conference that we're talking about that happens typically the third weekend in September. And you've seen them all on ham radio now.
Yep.
A niche interest, but a strong one. I mean, not that many people seem to be interested. You'd kind of expect in a technology hobby, and with so many things going more digital all the time, that they would get a stronger following. But it is not super strong. What it is those folks that do follow them are very dedicated.
Well, and you know what? You make it easier for people not to actually go to the conference.
We've discussed that.
And there's value, there's total value to that, but I also get because I wouldn't go ordinarily because, you know, time off work and this and that, but I can see all the speakers.
Yeah.
And even before, you know, we started together, I was watching the shows that you'd post. So,
I don't know. Well, there may be some people that don't go that do have a really strong interest and that might have gone if they didn't have the video.
Yeah.
That's not the way they look at it. I think that in part they see there's a strong handful of folks who have gone because they've seen it on video and say, this is something I really want to go to. The points that they make and are valid enough, I think, are that the talks themselves are no more than 50% of the value of going. The other half of the value is interaction with the people that are making presentations and just the other people that show up, because there's all that socializing that's going on at lunch, at dinner, in the evening.
Yep.
There's a lot of people. You pick the talks that you want to watch, and when you're not watching a talk that you want, you're out in the hallway talking to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Earnest, deep conversations, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people gathered together far enough from the door that they don't disturb the folks in the room, or they just close the door. So those are the things that are going on at the Tapper conference that the video doesn't get you. And those are the people that get really excited about it. So folks will go to the conference and they'll also give me $100.
Cool.
You know, 'cause they really want it to get out there.
Yeah.
It's hard to say whether the ultimate, it's a, you know, plus or a minus in terms of Tapper membership and attendance. There's no way to really measure that, but I think it's kind of a plus. Of course I would.
It's totally a plus. Yeah.
But that's one of the things I was wondering, you know, when I first approached them. Well, they actually, one of their guys approached me when he saw some of the talks that I had shot at Dayton and said, here's something we're doing in Tapper. It's in your old hometown this year in Chicago. You want to come out and shoot it? And I thought, well, give it a try. This is back when I was just doing DVDs, 2008. And that's one of the questions that I had for them is, you know, do you think this is going to take attendance away? And they didn't know, but what they've been watching since then. So it's now coming up on 9 years that it's, they think it's a net positive. But, cool. You know, for me, it's financially, it's either a loss or a wash.
Right.
If you add in the time, out of pocket expenses, you know, I do a little better than break even, but in terms of the time to produce the programs, it becomes a minimum wage job, restaurant minimum wage.
Labor of love. As long as you like what you're doing, it's a good thing.
I no longer absolutely need this to provide my income, but I need it to supplement my income. So it has to do something.
Yeah.
And as long as we're talking about that, and you picking up shows solo, the income that comes in from ham radio now, that from the folks that contribute, are the only reason I'm doing this. The view counts don't make it worthwhile. The ego doesn't make it worthwhile. When we look at the last bunch of shows that we've done, and we're seeing view counts below 1,000, I wouldn't do this for that.
Mm-hmm.
It's because the people who do watch and contribute to the program do so way above what any NPR or PBS station would expect from individual viewers in terms of a percentage, that I'm willing to keep on doing it. So I may be handing it to you entirely. I'll be a guest. We'll see what happens.
All right, I gotta get work in the studio then.
Yeah, yeah. I try to be pretty honest with audience about, you know, what I, you know, everything in the show, and that's one thing that, you know, I need to be honest about, is that lots of other shows, and I know why, you know, lots of, they do the smoke and solder, and they do the equipment reviews and the unboxings, and talk about contests and stuff, and we don't typically go there, and you may think that that's not a good strategy.
Yeah, it's a mix.
How can I complain about view counts if I'm not doing the shows that are going to bring in lots and lots of people? So that's, you know, that's a conundrum.
Yeah. Well, you know, the thing that we do that they don't do, and I think hopefully that's why we have an audience, is we peel back the layers of the onion to really get at it, where I think a lot of the other shows are, you know, just kind of shining a light on something and getting into it a little bit, but not a lot. And we do go long, and I know there's a couple other shows that go long, and there may be some level of a short show is easier to watch.
Oh, sure.
Because you're in the car, or you're doing your dishes, or you're whatever, and this is a commitment to sit down and follow along with for an hour, or let's see, an hour, 17 minutes right now.
Really? I thought we were doing this for about 15 minutes so far.
And that's probably part of the reason why we're doing it.
I should plant a big timer in front of me.
Yeah.
The audio helps, and I always forget to tell people up at front, because we get a big spike of viewers in the first 10 minutes, and then it falls off. I can see the view counts on YouTube and the what they call the audience retention. And on a typical show, even the shorter shows, even the 10, 15-minute shows, which are rare, but we do a few of them like that, they tend to hold up longer. But it drops below 50% within the first few minutes, and an hour show drops below 25% or hangs around 25% till the end of the show. So if you see a view count of 1,000, then you've really had 250 people watch the show. So what I need to do right up at the beginning is, because the audio audience is now starting to get bigger than the video audience, is to let people know that we're an audio podcast. This won't be. Because I'm not recording this.
That's a lower third, a quick lower third ad, right? Get your audio on whatever it is.
Oh, good point. Yeah,
that might be an easy way to get it remembered. And thank you, Emil. Emil said, "Love the show. It's real." And
yeah, well, he's one of those guys.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
So you go to work.
No, today, well, yeah, I actually go to
homework,
but I'm doing homework. It from home. Yeah, I got to go off to take my daughter to the doctor in a couple hours, but whatever. Thank you much.
Okay, you are?
I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. 73, everybody. We're not doing this on YouTube. There won't be anything flying in. Over.
I'm good. End out.
I think they really want us to say it.